Yeah, so it's recording now? It's great. So, I can't believe I'm number one. You guys are not doing anything. I forgot which stock. I bought either Amazon or Apple or Walmart. So one of the three. I don't know which one. But anyhow, so do you guys have any complaints, or you guys should trade more? And Jamie is trading 38, have 38 trades, and yeah, you guys should trade more, right? But however, if you wait, you want to wait till the market gets better and you want to start trading, it's probably a good idea. Yeah, but anyhow, this is a game. Yeah, so I put the APR EAR there. I don't know how to put it into one calculator, but if you put, for example, 12% APR every month, so this will be your answer here. So I also do the APR, for example, 12%, this is the answer. But I'm trying now to put it into one page. But not yet. It's not working yet. Anyhow, so this is a plan. I put all the plan for this semester. Yeah. So here it is. So we have two more exams. So I will give you guys exams to do next weekend, like next Friday at night. Next Friday maybe during the. At noon, I'll post the questions and I'll give you guys Friday night and Saturday whole day and Sunday whole day, and you know, no resting and to work on the exam. So and it should be due. Everybody should submit it like at midnight on Sunday. Yeah, but we still have classes. This is the plan. We may not have classes in week 7. Let's see. But the week 7, chapter 2 and 3 are just for the accounting things you guys just learned, but the focus will be on like a cash flow statement. But it's just like, I don't know how much you guys know about cash flow statement, but you can find, like, for example, calculating free cash flow. And so I have a calculator here for free cash flow and cash flow analysis. Cash flow statement analysis, this one. You should have learned it in the accounting class, so it's like a reveal to you guys. It shouldn't be too much trouble for this. Is so the last, the week 7. So we'll be in pace with the online class I'm teaching with BISC, and that's their schedule. So I'm recording the class mainly for them, not for you guys, because really no point to go back and go over the whole class again, right? Because it's just mainly for that classes. I'll post the homework again, homework help for you guys and for those people too, for those group of students too. I've done that and I'll post it tonight for the homework. So we have 14 questions. I've made the videos for each question. Yeah, so this is the plan, and then the exams for the midterm will be covering chapter 5, 6, and 7. So if you're comfortable with time value of money, bond pricing is really easy. Bond pricing is a lot easier than time value of money. So we may end today's class quicker, shorter. We may quicker today. Well, let's see. To get the help for bond pricing, let me just show you here. So we have bond calculator. This is a bond calculator here, and the guy. You can also go to his website. You can find this page here, but I just copied it here. So you just press a button so you can get the answer for bond pricing. So it's quite convenient. I'll show you how to use it. All right, now, I probably confused all of you guys. I don't know, I guess after the spring break, I've been doing lots of things during the spring break, make me nervous maybe, that's why, yeah. I don't know what you guys have done during the spring break. I know you guys are all working. Yeah, I've been doing things. Yeah. I just suddenly realized I got so many things that I need to do, but I haven't done that yet. That's why it drives me crazy. That's why I was talking too fast. But anyhow, I'll try to slow down. Anyhow, let's start. So do you, no, we haven't finished. We haven't finished the previous one yet. Yeah, here. But however, for that part, I've made the videos because this is for the online class students. So I've made the videos. This one should be the should be the video, the last one. But anyhow, it's because they need it to do the quiz for their class. But anyhow, for our class, we haven't finished it yet. We still have. I think we are at 14, right? We've done. No, we have 22. Yeah.
We finished
22, I think. Yeah. But you guys want to watch the video I made for this, or you want to work together on this? So we will jump to the new chapters. Because I made the videos for this part. If you click on this part, yeah, see. Yeah.
There's only what, 9 more questions left, right?
Yeah. Why there's no sound? Oh.
APR should be 12%.
Yeah, so
so it should be 12%. The present of the above payment, you see that.
So I've made the videos for each one of them. So I feel the last questions like we haven't done is not that difficult. It's not that difficult, but you guys can watch it. You guys can give it a try first and watch it. And if you have still have any questions, you can send me an email. And my office hour, I'll be in my office tomorrow. And like tomorrow between 3 and 6. And also on Wednesday, I'll be in my office from 2 to 3, 2 to 4, 2 to 5 maybe on Wednesday. And on Thursday, you won't find me on Thursday. Yeah, I'll be gone. But anyhow, send me an email or meet me at the Starbucks at Town Center. Yeah, at Town Center. All right, so let's, bond pricing. So I put you here, I update the information here. This is part of the balance sheet of Walmart. So I make the font bigger for long-term debt. So you see, this is long-term debt. And each one is in millions of dollars. Each one is in millions of dollars. So it's how big is this one? This is long-term debt of Walmart. So what is it? Who's lending so much money to Walmart? How much is it? How to read this number? I know billion, and then the next one should be after another three numbers should be that much of a trillion, right? And after trillion is how much? You guys know? Billion, millions and billions. This is how many billions, and this is how many trillions. So it's $43.52 trillion, right? Is that a huge number? But it's a lot. It's called long-term debt. It's called long-term debt. And when you calculate the ratio of long-term debt over total asset, it will be like for a dollar, for like every long-term debt is corresponding to like 5 times of its total asset. So it's like 20%. Long-term debt is 20% of its total asset. So what's this long-term debt? $43 trillion. Who's lending $43 trillion to, who has that much money? To Walmart. A lot, yeah. So how about you guys? How about you guys are like just regular or just typical investors? And you probably have some money lended to Walmart. You just didn't realize it because you have your mutual fund or a 401k retirement plan, right? Some professionals are managing your plan. You have some money invested in the fund, right? So even though it's a mutual fund, but you probably have a portion of your money lended to Walmart. Part of the money, the $43 trillion, part of that is like from you guys, including me. I just don't know like how the detail, how they diversified among the different bonds, but Walmart should be the good one, right? How about you guys, right? But how like the typical investor like us lend the money to Walmart? How do we know like we didn't know like Walmart needs money and borrow from us? So what's happening here?
Bank has given them money and sold.
Bank.
Mm-hmm. Bank is selling the bonds.
Business selling the bonds.
Yeah. Giving them the money. They have many banks.
Bank could be the brokers. Mm-hmm. Bank could be the brokers, and it was trying to sell the bonds for them. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Banks could be acting as the brokers. Yeah. But still, like for example, you have somebody has $5,000 available, somebody has $6,000 available, want to lend to Walmart. So is that possible for Walmart to negotiate one by one with each lenders? No, it has to be standardized, like stock, right? It's just like you buy per stock, you should buy per bond, right? You should buy like, I want how many bond, right? How many, just like you buy how many stocks, right? So bond, it's the same thing like stock. Bond, but however, bond is what? Unlike stock, you see total equity, this is stock. Stock is more than the long-term debt. But stock is like, investors are willing to give the money to Walmart. And whether or not they can make money, it's depending on Walmart. And there's no laws protecting stock market investors for like, you have to, investors are protected. It's no law like that, right? Investors are willing to invest in Walmart, whether or not they can make money is depending on how Walmart is doing in the future. But bond is different. Why? Because stock is just like investors are willing to invest in the company, but bond is different. Bond is your lender. Your Walmart is borrowing. So this is why it's called long-term debt. So Walmart is borrowing money from bondholders or lenders or debt holders. So if it's a lending, borrowing activities, so it should be protected, right? So somebody wants to borrow money from you, you will write a borrowing contract, right? So for Walmart, or for any companies want to borrow money, so it has to be standardized, so don't need to negotiate with lenders. Also, it has to be what? It has to be protected because it's contract. So for Walmart, it's obligation to pay back to how much to the lenders for how much they borrowed, right? And then they have to do what? They have to pay interest. But in the bond market, it's called a coupon. So they have to pay interest. They have to just say clearly when they will pay back to the bondholders or lenders or debt holders, right? So it's the same thing here. So even though it's a long-term debt, you can think about this is like from individual lenders out there, but each, it's just like they, even though it's standardized, but Walmart signs millions of individual contract to lenders, and each contract is standardized. So to make it easier, so each contract originally is worth how much? $1,000. That's called face value or par value or principal. So Walmart borrows $1,000 for each contract from each lenders. And then so Walmart will tell like how much interest they will pay back to investors every year, and also tell when they will pay back the whole $1,000 to the bondholders. That's called maturity. Well, bond will be matured at the date. And then after matured and payment are done. Lenders received every payment, every coupon, and that means the contract is over. And that means there's no more obligations for Walmart anymore. Yeah, so that's long term. That's the whole thing. So you see, bond is pretty simple in that the values are cash flows are known. The cash flows are cash flows are just like investors will pay for this bond now, and then investors will be getting coupon every year, and investors will get the $1,000 back, in the end. And that's all. So nothing is hidden. Nothing is tricky. No games can be played in this. Yeah, so right? So whatever the market is doing, as long as Walmart is in operation, so Walmart has to keep up with the payment. Otherwise, Walmart will be in trouble, will be forced to liquidate the assets. Still, they have to pay back to the bondholders. Unlike to the stockholders, dividend payment decisions are up to the management, not up to like the regulations. It's not contract, but the bond is part of the contract. So you see, it's pretty clear. The cash flows you see here, the cash flows is, if you buy the bond, you're the bondholders, you'll be getting coupon payment one each year. By the end of the first year, second, third, fourth year, and then at maturity date, you get your last coupon payment and also receive the par value, which is $1,000. You get a bigger bag in the end. So that's because once you buy the bond, you become the bondholder, you know exactly the cash flows you're getting. So you probably wondered, then what else we're doing here? So you just pay for this bond, and you know exactly how much you're getting back. So why we're bothered by nothing, right? So you should have no worries, right? So as a bond investors, once you pay, you bought this bond, you should be worry-free? No. Any, because bond is also investment. We always know bond is safer, but still have risk. So what kind of risk you think bond would have? Walmart out of business, right?
Yeah,
they don't pay back, yeah. So what else? Like nowadays, interest rate is on the track, on the track to go up. Interest rate go up, and we know as bond investors, your value will go up or go down. Go down, yeah. As the bond investors, you worry for interest rate should go up, because interest rate go up, your bond portfolio value will go down. So that's another risk. You may lose money, even though you're getting, Walmart is the operation, you always get your money back. But when you're calculating the returns, you may get lower return than you expect when interest rate goes up. Yeah, so you see interest rate is changing all the time, and also bond price is determined by what? For example, anybody want to buy Walmart bond?
Yeah, sure.
Sure, yeah, you say, yeah, Julia want to buy bond of Walmart, right? You go to buy bond and you bought, for example, you bought millions of dollars of bond of Walmart, and drive up the demand, drive up the price, right? Bond price is determined by the demand and supply. So when Julia kind of investors bought millions of dollars of bond at Walmart, price will go up and returns will go down. Price will go up. So you see, price is always changing because for liquidity problems or for other reasons, there will be traders out there buying and selling Walmart bond, and the price will therefore go up and down. When price go up and down, the returns to bondholders will change accordingly. Yeah, so in this chapter, what we'll do is just like once we know the returns to the bondholders, we should know how to calculate the price and vice versa. Yeah, so sounds easy, right? Cash flows are known, all these are known. So what don't know, what we don't know is price of the bond, and also yield to maturity of the bond. Yeah. For example, how much you think a Walmart bond is trading for? For example, bond will be matured in 2030. So we have like how long? 11 years left for this bond. If you buy, you can buy this bond. You're getting 7.55% of coupon. So how much cash flows you're getting? How much money you're getting for this bond every year? 7.55% is the coupon rate or the interest rate. How much is this bond, the whole package worth? 1,000, right? 1,000. So how much coupon is that? So the whole package is $1,000. 7.55% is the promised coupon payment, interest payment. It has 75.5. You use 1,000 multiplied by the 7.55%. That is your coupon. So it's just like if you look at this little bag, this one will be 75.5 the next year, another 75.5 next year, all the way till 2030. At 2030, you get 75.5 plus $1,000. $1,000, but you have to wait till 11 years to get your last payment of coupon and the par value. You see, so you see from here, 7.55% is the coupon rate. For dollar amount you're getting, use 7.55% times 1,000. Right, so, yeah, so that's a cash flow. And then, so symbol, this is just name of this bond. This bond is not callable. So there's no next call date or callable. So this bond, Walmart will never could cancel the contract. If it's callable, and Walmart could cancel this bond if they think it's not to their best interest, they can cancel that. And last trading price, you see, and last trading yield, these two informations are changing all the time. I just got the information a while ago. So last trading price, if you go to the market, this is the price you have to pay. They pay $75.50 of coupon. This is really high for something worth $1,000, because now interest rate is how much? Around 3% something. So they pay more than. So they pay more than the market it is. So the price is what? The price should be hot, right? Yeah, so demand should be high, right? So price will go up. But you see it's 138.5. But think about, this is a percent of 1,000. The package is $1,000. So this bond is 138.45% of the whole package. So if you want to pay for this bond, how much you have to pay? 138.45% multiplied by 1,000. So you pay $1,384.50. Because this is a good investment, because they pay high coupon. So investors are willing to pay more than the package worth, which is 1,000. So now the current price, you can move the decimal to the right for one position, or think about this is the percentage and multiply by 1,000.
Is everything 1,000?
Everything is 1,000. The package, the whole package is $1,000. Yeah, but however the price is either higher than that or lower than that. Yeah, and then so if you buy this one for $1,384.50, your return is how much? This is your return. You're getting 3.318% every year. If you buy for that price and you hold it till it is matured at year 2030. Yeah. You see, so the information is always changing, are these two numbers. Price is always changing because demand and supply. People trade for multiple reasons, like liquidity. They just need the money for other purposes, so they sell their bond. Or they want to rebalance their portfolios for risk concerns. So the price is always changing depending on demand and supply. And when price is changing, then the yield will be changing. Let's give it a try. For example, this is the price. Now let's figure out why the yield is 3.318%. So how much money we're getting? Yeah, let's assume now it's let's assume we have this is 19, yeah, and so we have 11 years left to this bond. Yeah, you pay $1,384.50. This is the PV here. This is PV. This is present value. And how much is the coupon? Coupon is a PMT. $75.50. That's a PMT. Okay, so let's use 11 years left, because 19 and 30. Let's use 11 years. Let's just consider like the next coupon payment will be 2020. So we have 2020 and the last one 2030. So we have 11 years left. And then so let's use Empress 11, and then future value. Future value is the last package besides this coupon. Is how much? It's a package worth. So Walmart will pay back the $1,000 they borrowed back to the investors. So the FV should be $1,000. FV should be $1,000 here. FV is always $1,000 for bond. FV is just like the last payment besides the coupon. So last payment should be $1,000. That's the money they borrow, yeah.
So what you're saying is the starting price is $1,000, so the future value, the maturity price should be $1,000 as well?
Yeah, but the bond now, the bond is offering high coupon, and you can find the detail of the bond. You see, the bond is here. Offering date is year 2000. That's why interest rate is high. So at this date, it is $1,000 offering. You see, original offering is $1,000. But see, but it's on this date, year 2000. But when it's first issued, it is $1,000. The package is $1,000. But once it's started traded in the market, and the price will go around $1,000. It could be higher or lower. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so nowadays the price is not $1,000. The price is this one, $1,384.50. You see? So it's not $1,000 anymore, but Walmart still owes to the bondholders $1,000. They still owe $1,000. You see, so if you click on this one, so you see the detail of this bond, including the price. See, this is a price chart. Even though it says around a hundred something, think about this is like $1,000. You can just move the position to the right for one position. But you see, it should be So you see, it should be $100 is just $1,000 here. So it's the price has been beyond $1,000 because of what? Because interest rate has been going down since 2002, has been going down since 2002, and the price has been going up. But each time you see the price was dropping, it's either financial problem, people start selling their bond, and then, or just because the interest rate has been going up. It's just not because the Fed has increased interest rate. It could be like Walmart is in trouble. People consider Walmart is getting riskier, so people start selling their bond. So price will go down, and then yield will go up. But anyhow, you see the price, it should be around $1,000, but you see price has gone up because the returns or yield to maturity, yield to bondholders or return to bondholders are lower. But anyhow, it's once you do some exercise, it will be clear. Yeah, did you guys got it? How much is the yield to maturity? Did you get something? let's try this bond calculator. Let's give it a try here. Price is how much? And now I'll show you Excel. And 13,845. But put negative. This is price. Coupon is 755. Face value for bond is always 1,000. And coupon and face value always put positive number. And yield is the question. Period is, let's use 11. And make it annual coupon bond. Annual coupon bond means the bond is paid once a year. And let's see. It should be around like 3.32. Yeah, because we're not using exactly the same date. But anyhow, you see it's similar. but put annual. Maybe we do 12, it's more accurate. No. Three point three two. Yeah, we got exactly the same. 3.31, 3.31, 3.318. We got 3.32 here. To do the Excel, we should use the. To do the Excel, you can use the rate function. So 11 years, coupon. Face value, it's 1,000. Type, you can ignore. That's all. If you do Excel. So you see it's right? So once you know the price, you can figure out the yield. And once you know the yield, you can figure out the price. And that's all for this chapter. Face value is always 1,000. Right. So you try this Excel. You should get the same. Financial rate.
So the price, you move it to the decimal over the right one time, and also the coupon.
Yeah. So if you use Excel, now you see. You go to see, and the input should be rate is the question. Emperor is 11. Payment is coupon. Payment is coupon, 75.5. Both are positive. Coupon, MPV should be market price, but negative. FE, it's always 1,000. This is the package worth. It's called PA, or face value.